This is Trish Parnell with PKids Podcast, and today we're talking to Nurse Mary Beth Coughlett-Pachacco. Hello, Nurse Mary Beth.
Hello, Trish. How are you?
I'm just fine. How are you?
I'm just wonderful. How nice to hear you again.
Oh, you too. Now, Nurse Mary Beth, I hope that you have your brain screwed on tight.
Because I hope it is. We're in trouble if it isn't.
I know. We're going to talk about herbal medicines today. And this field is just so contentious at times, and you know, with our chronically affected families, and then just with families who want to use some herbal medicine for a cold or something. So I kind of want to talk about, what does FDA have to say about this stuff? Is it regulated at all, and is it dangerous, and does it interact with other drugs? Just, you know, I want parents to get a kind of a basic idea that should they just pick up something off the grocery store shelf and use it, do they need to be checking something out before they use it?
Well, those are all terrific questions. And yes, they definitely do need to be checking something out. I think the number one thing that parents have to realize about herbal medicines is they're medicines, just like anything else that they would be giving their children. The big problem with herbal medicines is they are not regulated by the FDA.
Not at all.
Not at all.
Wow.
You can just say, oh, I'm going to put this in this particular tea out, and I'm going to claim it does this. And because it's classified as a food, the FDA really doesn't have anything to any kind of control over that. And that includes any kind of herbal products, vitamins, minerals, amino acids, which are some of the things that some of the teenagers are trying to get into for bodybuilding. So the legislation really allows anything to be advertised as to how they affect the human body without any kind of regulation.
You know, I remember speaking to Phil Rosenthal, who's a pediatric hepatologist. A lot of families were interested in one or two herbal medicines for their kids who are living with chronic Hep B or C. And he said, and these were well studied. He said, but the problem is, you don't know if it's the stem or the bud or the leaf and you know, what percentage of each is in the bottle. So it's not exactly the same each time.
That's exactly the problem. There's no standard for what the dose is for each one of those medicines. And it also could vary from company to company. It could vary from bottle to bottle. So you might be giving your child a very mild dose of whatever it is you're giving them one time, and the next time you could literally be overdosing them.
So just to be clear, herbal products are made from plants or the part of a plant. Just, you know,
yes,
that's what we're talking about when we're talking about herbal products.
That's right. It's any kind of a tea, a powder, a pill, or a supplement that is made from a living plant.
Okay,
or
so
some part of the plan.
Let's assume that because the parents that we help whose kids are chronically infected with something, they've discussed this at length, and we've done quite a few articles on this. So let's just talk about families who are using it just, you know, like for a cold or a fever or nothing, you know, nothing that's a chronic illness. So is it dangerous, or what can it do to a child, or you know, and I realize it depends, I guess, on the herb, but what can you tell us about that?
Well, it does really depend on the herb, and it does depend on the dose. There are some things that are perfectly safe for children, but again, it's rather than saying what those specifics are, I think any time you want to give your child any kind of an herbal medicine, it's really important that you discuss that with your provider. I mean, some of the things that are around are ginseng for nausea and green tea. Everybody knows green tea these days because it's supposed to really help with blood pressure and regulating cholesterol. Echinacea has been around for a while, and that's supposed to be very helpful for colds. The only thing is that the data that we have on echinacea is that it really does not help. Some of the others might be kava kava or St. John's wort. Now, St. John's wort is used for depression. And that's something you must be extremely careful with. And certainly I would not want parents giving that to their children without discussing that those medicines. Some parents feel, well, you know, with ADD or ADHD, the provider might recommend putting the child on meds, and the parent might say, well, I'd rather use herbal medicines. But the herbal medicines, thinking that the herbal medicines would be of less risk to the child when it very well might be a worse of a risk. just to give you an example of some of the side effects are ephedrine, and that's one of the things that people do take for colds and stuffiness, and that can make your increase the blood pressure. It can make people feel jittery, give children headaches. They might have difficulty sleeping.
Wow.
Ginkgo biloba is another one that we hear a lot about, and that can cause your child to be much more prone to bleeding.
Oh.
I mean, you've got a child who's in sports, and you're feeding them ginkgo biloba, and they're getting black and blues, and before that, you know, that might be a much more extensive bruise because they're taking the ginkgo.
Yeah.
And then I just mentioned the St. John's wort for depression, which can cause an upset stomach, some tiredness, dizziness, confusion, and dry mouth. These are real drugs, and I think parents have to realize that.
And don't they need to be careful if your child is on, let's say, antibiotics or something, don't they need to be careful that whatever they're giving their child isn't going to interact with the prescription drug?
Oh, yes, absolutely. Like, now, we don't give children aspirins, but ginkgo cannot be given to anybody with aspirin because it's going to increase the bleeding. St. John's wort shouldn't be taken with antidepressants because it's just going to increase the effect of the antidepressants. Mm. And kava kava shouldn't be taken with the benzodiazepines, which are sometimes given for children with seizure disorders.
Mm.
And if your child has any conditions such as elevated blood pressure, heart disease, diabetes, thyroid disease, the behavioral disorders, remember I just mentioned to you that a lot of parents think that using the herbal medicines are safer than using the prescribed medicines that the provider might offer, but an epilepsy or a blood clotting disorder, any of those conditions should very carefully be discussed with the provider before giving any kind of herbal medicine.
Wow. Well, I know that there are millions of families interested in CAM, complementary and alternative medicine. But
I think there's certain parts of alternative medicine are absolutely wonderful and extremely helpful.
Yeah. We encourage, when it comes to herbal medicines, we encourage parents to always, always talk to their child's provider. So
absolutely. And another good resource for the parent, besides talking to the provider, is calling up the pharmacist.
Oh, really?
The pharmacist is a specialist in medications. When I've had some parents say tell me that their children were on one herb or another, and I really was not familiar with that particular herb at all, I called the pharmacist, who was able to look it up. They have access to certain websites, and I found the pharmacist to be a wealth of information about herbal medicine.
That's a good idea.
That's exactly what they go to school for, and they can also review the medicines that the children are on, related to what kind of herbal medicines that the parent might want to offer their children.
I hadn't even thought about that with herbal medicine.
The pharmacists are fabulous resources. In fact, like I said, if I have questions about herbal medicines, I go right to the pharmacist.
Okay,
that's
excellent.
Their specialty.
So anything, walk-away thought for this, herbal medicine and kids?
Well, I think the walkaway is please don't give your child any herbal medicines unless you discuss them with your provider and or your pharmacist. And the community pharmacists are very happy to answer questions if you call and say, I want to talk to the pharmacist regarding herbal medicines or any medicine for that matter with them. They are specialists in medicines. They are specialists in how the medicines are given. And I have found them to be extremely excellent resources when I have questions about medication.
Good. Perfect. Okay, well, as always, thank you so much. You certainly covered it.
Thank you very much for calling me.
All right, we'll talk to you soon.
Take care, Trish.
Bye.
Bye-bye.